2116, you can fly across town in minutes, or across the globe in under an hour. Whole communities are living on Mars, and solar satellites provide Earth with unlimited clean power. In less than a century, Boeing took the world from seaplanes to space planes, across the universe and beyond. And if you thought that was amazing, you just wait.
There we go. Well, thanks for being here. It's nice to be looking out at a few of the chairs being full and being able to talk a bit about cooperation through really a discussion of an organization that has been involved in creating cooperative standards for space communication since 1982. Joining me as panelists here, first of all, to my immediate left, Dr. James Afarin, who is the current chair of the CCSDS, that is this cooperative institution. Next to him is Eduardo Bergamini from Brazil, and Naser Al Rashedi, with whom I think I've shared maybe three panels in the last year, so on the far side of the panel. So what we're going to do is simply allow the panelists to make some brief remarks about their relationship to this cooperative process, and then we'll get into a few questions that'll pull out some of the history and the dynamic of this pretty well-established international cooperative institution, and then hopefully get to some questions from you. So first of all, James, if you could give us insight to CCSDS and your role there.
Yes, I reside at the NASA headquarters. I'm basically the standard manager for space communication for NASA, and I joined the CCSDS in 2009, and by 2012, I was chair of the what we call the CCSDS Management Council, and we have about 26 working group, six areas of cooperation. It's a 35-year-old organization, and basically it's developed by for the spacefaring nations to do cooperative work and be some place that they can develop standards, interoperable standards that also agree to, and they all develop it together. It's the membership is like 11 agencies, member agencies we have. We have over 31 observer agency, which is Mohammed bin Rashid is just become an observer agency just this year. And also we have over 118 commercial association. And we also are part of ISO internationally, and our standards are published in ISO. We cover in everything from ground space all the way to the space vehicle. And it is all the standards are developed cooperatively with all the nations. They are free for everybody to use. And they are pre-competitive level of standards. So every nation wants to develop the standards, they can develop their own specific how to use the standards. But they're all the best mind in the world come over there to develop space communication. And it's one of the really a shining example of cooperation for internationally. And we pays dividend and, you know, many folds for all the agencies that are involved in there. Currently, our data shows that over 825 missions been using this CCSDS standards, which is incredible. And we have over 150 publication, and since inception, we have over 336 standards. Standards not only developed through the protocols, not only developed through the cooperative work, we also do verification and validation through two separate agencies, So once we develop the standards and they are in what we call Blue Book, they are ready to be used for any agencies they required. And one of the main things is the cross support and interoperability, one of the main benefits of the our standards. So we are very pleased that we be able to contribute to the space community, and our infrastructure and our data and our know-how has been used by many other organizations of CCSDS, Air Force, and other groups to come and use our infrastructure.
Well, thank you very much. Eduardo, you've been a part of this organization since its inception. Be interesting to hear your perceptions of...
Yeah, I had the privilege of being with CCSDS since the beginning. At the beginning was a somewhat painful process. It's amazing to see how cooperation can grow, internationally speaking, in such an area as space data systems. And but we had very enthusiastic persons, very capable ones, and the first recommendations for standardization came out very shortly after the creation of CCSDS back in 82, and start to be used a little afterwards. Start with telemetry, and then telecommand came in, and or the RF and modulation. And we could see that many, as Dr. Afarin said here, many missions start using effectively these standards. And eventually by the 90s, in the beginning of the 90s, word came in our management council there in CCSDS that would be advisable to try to expand this or permeate this standards, recommendation for standards in the ISO domain, which in fact occurred in 91, 92. And it's a reality that we have today many ISO standards which are simply originated from CCSDS, and under a cover sheet process, they become, going through the stage that are required by ISO, they become standards, ISO standards, under the subcommittee 13 of TC-20. TC-20 is the Aircraft and Space Vehicles Technical Committee of ISO. We have a broader subcommittee also in space operations and interface, is SC-14. They have also many interesting standards. They kind of complement, I would say, CCSDS standards. We have been always in liaison with them to try to complement each other at system level, at least. And back to SC-13, these standards reach for many more countries, as you may know. We have more than 10 members, P members of SC-13, and many others observers as well. So it's a reality. We have today a whole suite of standards, and the good thing about CCSDS is that we are always looking for advanced technology, and the creation of a new standard has a fairly short turnaround. So it's fairly common to have some old standards that are superseded by new ones. Of course, in many cases, downward compatible with the older ones. Those who have implemented those standards, in principle, have no major problem in adapting to the new ones. But above all, the importance of these standards that they make it possible to have interoperability between among systems, and most important, maybe it was the most important keyword for CCSDS is cross supportability, and we say about we mean in the international scenario, and this is happening. One of the, just to exemplify, space link extension standards are being used for many years now. My agency in Brazil has an interface for telecommand and telemetry with ESA in Darmstadt. NASA and ESA and Russian space agency, they also have this capability, I know, for many missions. And as you may understand, the more we practice these standards, the better they become spread over those who are the stakeholders. So the topic of this panel here is very opportune to announce to you that there is certainly room for any country that really want to contribute with the use of these standards. So basically, this is what I have to say.
Yeah, I think, Eduardo, that leads pretty well into what Naser might be able to talk to us about, because you, Naser, are a user of these standards without being a part of the actual agencies that are the member agencies. Why don't you give us some of your insights to your relationship with this cooperative endeavor?
Thank you, Mike, and thanks for the organizers for having this important panel and all the participant time. I think, first of all, CCSDS has actually proven that standards is an enabler for innovation, sustainability and stability in the space environment. And many times, people sometimes in space used to sometimes think about, you know, standards could be about restriction, but CCSD over the last 35 years proven the opposite. It has proven that standard is actually an enabler for innovation, for stability in the space environment and activities, and eventually the long-term sustainability. Of course, now we have about 150 standards. Most of these standards, if not all of them, most of the countries that are having space missions are following. There is about 800 missions that has been benefiting from the standards of the consultative committee. We are proud to have one of our government operators as an observer, and they're very active, and I know that they are using the standards and benefit from that. But what I would like to also state is that the importance of this consultative committee is actually increasing due to the change that is happening on the space environment. We have, you know, it used to be civil, scientific, now we're seeing much more commercial coming towards even the left side, if you allow me to say, of the value chain, coming towards the R&D, coming towards the scientific missions, but also based from coming from a commercial players. Space in general is becoming congested, where we need efficiency, we need interoperability. It's becoming contested, and the series, I think it's the 350 series that you come up with the standard on security threats, taking into account also the cyber part, is an outstanding, you know, initiative. Also, it's becoming definitely much more competitive, and with this, as mentioned earlier, it allows joint missions. It also allows healthy competition because without a standard, you can't really judge if, you know, the operator is doing the best effort or not. so you have at least a bar where you can tell that operator is actually following best practice versus those who are not taking this into account. I think in general, we are looking forward to see more members to this to the committee, and maybe more involvement of the committee with other UN organizations. The last point maybe I would also like to make in here and stress on, when I compare space sector to, for example, the telecom sector, the nuclear sector, the let's say the aviation sectors, these sectors are, I would say, if you allow me to say, overstandardized. You have from UN organizations, for example, like the ITU, you have very detailed standards for frequency usage and other even industry standards and so on. You go to the nuclear, it's also, you know, there is very well established standards. You go to the aviation with all the annexes and all the good job that is being done by ICAO, you see a lot of good. Under the UN system, there is not much about space. You have, you know, more in terms of maybe treaties, a little bit of the guidelines. So the job and the work that is done by the consultative committee is very essential, because that augments what UN is doing in terms of United Nations Outer Space Office is doing and COPUS is doing, because they don't get into that level. And we need that flexible, efficient arm like a consultative committee to complement and augment what is missing under the UN.
Well, thank you. I'd like to follow up actually on a point you raise and share it with the panel. You talk about this important role of actually facilitating innovation. And so cooperation is not only an aspiration, it's a process. So I'd like, James, maybe you could start off by talking to us about how an innovative idea for a standard would be presented and then processed through the consultative committee to sort of show how this dynamic part of standards actually works.
So for the NASA, we have you know, actually five centers that field centers that work on these things, and most of these standards ideas come on a grassroots. The mission managers and people that design the missions, and they see a need for a standard, and they raise it to every center has its own standard manager, that this is a good idea to have a standard. So that innovative idea comes up into the working group that's specifically for that standard, let's say navigation, and then present it to internationally. You know, we have this idea, who's interested, which nation would be interested in that. And once that interest is established, we develop what we say white book, which says, basically defines what the standard's supposed to be, and then goes basically worldwide, that white book, and make sure that everything is covered, is also, you know, is comprehensive, is technically sound, is the whole process is laid out, that how do we develop from the idea all the way to a standard that can be used, and then with the working group, come bring it up to the management council for approval and funding, and we every 6 months we get together face to face from 11 nations, and we approve it, we fund it, and they go ahead and start developing standard. And every step of the way, you know, they have been reviewed by all the agencies and all the centers. I mean, for NASA, when the standard has been developed, will have to be reviewed. They go to all five centers. Every center have like, tens of experts to look into it. So make sure that everything is completely accurate and comprehensive, and then builds up for the one review of NASA, and then goes up. So it's a various level of accuracy in this thing. And at the end of the day, when everything is corrected, then we actually have to develop prototype to make sure this thing is working, which is basically our own validation and verification process. And then the standard is developed and is ready to be used by everybody in the world. Mm-hmm. It's a free standard. Everybody can go in on our website and pick it up and implement that however they want to. Well,
Eduardo, you get the opportunity to have to take these standards from the consultative committee and present them to ISO. Are there any other hoops you need to jump through in order to get ISO to adopt the standards from the CCSDS?
The fact that getting to the ISO domain, the process basically cover sheet process, it does make the passing through all the stages of ISO regular processing makes this end-to-end process much more rapid. This is especially important because CCSDS has a review each 5 years of these recommendations for standards and the best practice, as we say, that go to ISO for getting standards there. And they are synchronized with ISO, so this makes the process much more faster. And of course, there is also the fact that some of the CCSDS recommendations, they are eventually turned, as we call it, silver books. So they are superseded by a new recommendation or simply phased out. And this has consequence in the ISO domain as well. But there is an important thing here. Of course, you may ask, well, but you have implemented this standard that was interrupted in the process of CCSDS. Well, okay, this doesn't mean that your implementation will be outmoded or incompatible, because there are ways of, let's say, interface your system with the new ones. A very, very high concern in CCSDS, the system architecture group, they take care that you have, as possible, interoperability between those different segments of end-to-end space architecture that CCSDS observes. More than this, security reserves are cared for in all these phases of the end-to-end architecture. So CCSDS is always looking at the end-to-end model when you introduce any new item or substitute an node one by a new one. This is very important. So I think I respond to your question.
Yeah, I think that covers it pretty well. Naser, is a user, we've heard the things that you really like about the program. Is there any suggested change that you feel that could be useful or evolution in the way the committee responds with people who are not at the table but very actively using the standards?
Well, thanks for asking this question, Mike. Again, so I think what the consultative committee is doing is just great. The approach, as we've heard earlier, is just brilliant. All the life cycle, all the steps in drafting, everything is online, very well organized. Also the different types of books that they have. And then also towards the end, once a standard or a recommendation is done, it's actually published, it's free, you don't have to. So I think this is a brilliant approach, and they have all the different type of members. So what we're looking here is a little bit of an optimization. What we're looking for is maybe more members. Today we have only 11 members. We have 28 observers. We have 140 associates in there, so that's great. But in terms of members, 11, we look forward to increase the number of space agencies in there. That's something that, so maybe we need to maybe have much more marketing in terms of having more agencies involved in the process. The second thing is, I think, also the participation, the representation in other UN, especially the ones related to space, maybe during the CUPUS and others, to have maybe much more reporting about the success and outcomes that is coming from there, and also bringing the attention maybe doing some mapping between the guidelines that are discussed in CUPUS, whether the long-term sustainability or the nuclear guidelines or the debris guidelines, doing a mapping between what is happening in the what the CUPUS is talking about in terms of guidelines and the standards that are being developed by the CCSDS. That's in general. But I just want to add one thing about the innovation that you talked about. And because this is very important, I always have these debates with sometimes industry about standards versus innovation, and more it's really proving. And I think one of the things that I heard a nice story before that from one of the industry who was approaching us, and the guy, he said, do you guys have standards in space? I said, you're the first company that comes to me and asks me about standards. Usually they ask me, do you have a law? But they don't like to hear the words. I said, no. I have an investor whose only question is if the country they're gonna, you know, that you're gonna operate from or get a license from have a standard, I'll be more than happy to, you know, to invest in there, because I know if there is a standard, that means there is some risk management, that means that there is interoperability, that means that there is some efficiency, there will be, you know, a way that I can also monitor whether you are performing accordingly or not. So I think this is a great insight that I heard from the industry.
Yeah, it's interesting. You've heard me say this, but maybe others haven't, that there's a lot of talk about space being congested, contested, and competitive. But it now also is congested, contested, and invested. And investors are increasingly looking for security. And standards provide a certain security, just of course as does transparency, just as does a regulatory environment that's understandable and reasonable. And so it's part of this change that we're all seeing in the space sector that's really quite intriguing. Before I pose any more questions, is there anybody out in the audience that would like to pose a question to the panel? Okay, so one more at least. Has the CCSDS ever made a technical presentation to COPIOS on its abilities? You know, they have these opportunities at every scientific and technical committee, subcommittee session, and general session to make technical presentations. Have you ever made one of those? Because I must say, I agree with Naser. You do not hear your organization discussed often at COPIOS.
Yes, I think we made a lot of presentations to internally to our own agency. Space communication, future space communication architecture is purely based on CCSDS standards.
Mm-hmm.
So it's well regarded and well counted on to make sure that we have appropriate standards. So for the NASA to build all their activities all the way going through Mars and, you know, surface of Mars by 2040 or whatever it have to be done. We made a lot of presentation internal to the missions, but nothing external outside. Although we have a liaison with the 12 different organizations such as OMG, IOAG, and IETF, which is internet organization for terrestrial, and they're all well known, and we work very closely with these companies. I don't know if you heard about standard DTN, which is a disruptive tolerant network standard, and that we will develop it, and we basically give it to IETF to maintain it and have a safe keep it, and so they can use it all over the world. So the cooperative agreement among everybody that we have touched, all the agencies, all the missions happens all the time, but we don't have, capacity at NASA and stuff, I haven't made that specific presentation outside the right. NASA's mission and stuff.
No, I think it could be, it certainly would be informative to COPIOS. So, I mean, it might be something to think about for a future session, because they are so focused now on guidelines and on the development of what will be an agenda setting document with Unispace plus 50, that it could be a good contribution to tomorrow's standards.
We'll be well interested to do that. We have a lot of cooperative with Air Force, with many other, you know, U.S. Agencies, and they use the standards. And one of the shining examples that we have is our infrastructure is so well established and so well planned that a lot of organizations come and use our infrastructure, our technology, and our people, the brains of a worldwide knowledge of this space communication to develop standards. We developed a standard for U.S. Air Force, the collision avoidance standards, which was done purely on our navigation working group with cooperation of all of, you know, 11 agencies. Mm. So this was a shining example that the standard, what can you do?
Right, and a lot of hard work along the
yes,
way.
Yes, yes.
It's pretty amazing. So right. We're getting close to the end of our time. Do any one of you have an additional sort of final comment you'd like to make?
Can I say something?
Yes, please.
CCSDS also has liaisons, as James cited here, but they have also associates. So if you are a member or a observer of CCSDS, nothing precludes that a scientific or industrial entity of your country or of your federation, whatever, may become a contributor to CCSDS, okay? So this is predicted in CCSDS constitution. So they are allowed even to participate in the technical committees of CCSDS, provided they are endorsed by the country or the federation that they are organized in. So this is very important. Concerning forums, Space Ops conference has a very important topic there, cross support and interoperability standards. It's held every 2 years. Actually, the committee met in Dubai some months ago, and because I think Dubai is a member of Space Ops today, and is a very good forum. Many papers are presented there, very good ones, related to CCSDS standardization and other related topics as well. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Anything to conclude, Nazar?
I think everything.
You're going to take these standards to Mars, we're going to follow that. We're going to be cheering along that mission. And certainly to all of you, those using the standards, those developing them, I hope the audience recognizes just how much hard work goes in to a standard that's respected enough to have been adopted in over 820 missions. Now, hopefully, you also know how to make some input if you've got an idea for a standard that's going to take humankind more deeply and more successfully into space. So thank you for being a part of this panel, and let's have some applause for the participants.